Less than 48 hours after Joe Beaver's body is found in a highway ditch, South Dakota Attorney General Jason Ravnsborg sends out a statement on official Attorney General letterhead. Ravnsborg says the reason for his silence regarding the fatal accident he's responsible for is to respect the investigation. The letter says, quote, "There are many rumors and stories being told and reported which do not represent a full and factual account of what happened." He talks about the Spink County Lincoln Day dinner in September of 2020 and says on the drive back to pier, his vehicle, quote, "struck something that I believe to be a large animal, likely a deer." In the letter, Ravnsborg says he's cooperating fully with investigators. He says he's saddened by the tragic nature of the events and offers heartfelt condolences to the Beaver family. Ravnsborg says he will make himself available for questions once the investigation is complete. To this day, he has not voluntarily made himself available for any interviews. I'm Lee Strubinger, and this is SDPB's Short Walk, a look at the arc of one political career, the events of a dark night, and the ripple effects. Ravnsborg is elected to the Attorney General's office in the fall of 2018. What he lacks in experience, he makes up for in support from the party faithful. On election night, he wins with 55% of the vote. It's a moment 4 years in the making to become the state's top law enforcement official.
Now, while it's a good day for South Dakota, it's a bad day for drug dealers. As they said in the debate, they had 86 days to reform their lives. I'm telling you now, you got 60 left. Because we're going to do everything we can do to keep South Dakota safe.
Before now, Ravnsborg has never won an election. He's never served in the state legislature or in a local elected position. He's best described as a lawyer, a party activist, and a military veteran. But in the years leading up to his bid to helm the office of the Attorney General in the Mickelson Building, Ravnsborg shows a keen understanding of the state's political landscape and his quest for power. Jason Ravnsborg's run in a statewide election begins in 2014, when he seeks a seat in the United States Senate.
I'm a private citizen who just got fed up enough to say, let's throw the bums out. And I'm trying to carry through. And I'm also trying to get my opponents to be pinned down on where they stand on the issues.
Democratic Senator Tim Johnson is not seeking re-election. That opens the floodgates for a Republican hoping to fill the seat and become part of a Senate majority. A handful of Republicans run in the primary, including some of the party's key leaders. There are also a few outsider candidates in the race. And then, late in the game, comes Ravnsborg, a little-known lawyer from Yankton who's a lieutenant colonel in the U.S. Army Reserves.
I've actually got 17 years and counting. I'm still in the Army Reserves. I've been on three tours so far. I've been to Germany, Iraq, and Afghanistan. I was awarded a Bronze Star, and I was actually honored before Congress in 2006. I believe that that brings a lot of strength of character and values that I've learned, but also discipline. We have to have some discipline.
Ravnsborg has had four company commands. At one point, he's a battalion commander overseeing 600 soldiers in North and South Dakota, Nebraska, and Missouri. The combat veteran says he has the credentials to put up a successful campaign.
And when I looked at the lineup of who was in it, I said, you know what? This guy could win. He could actually win.
That's Ken Crow, who goes by several titles.
I don't know. Some call me a political operative. Some call me a consultant. Some call me a campaign manager. I just kind of show up for work and do what needs to be done.
Crow is from Iowa. He says he's one of the originators of the Tea Party, a conservative wing of the Republican Party that got its start around 2009 during President Barack Obama's first term in the White House.
And I got this phone call one day from a friend of mine who was a Tea Party guru sort of fellow.
The friend says there's this guy in South Dakota who's going to run for U.S. Senate and needs someone to help his campaign. The friend wonders if Crow is interested. He gives Ravnsborg a call. They talk for a few hours on the phone, and then...
I decided, you know what? I have a bad habit sometimes of taking up causes that I believe in rather than what is the most financially beneficial to me and my family.
He joins the race as Ravnsborg's campaign manager. Crow says Ravnsborg's message is solid. He's pro-life, pro-Second Amendment, fiscally conservative, and against Obamacare, all requirements for a Republican campaign in South Dakota.
The other thing that I really liked about him was he, I'm not going to say charismatic, but he was very approachable. And he was really good on the stump with shaking hands and meeting people, and he was very gracious.
But there's a problem. Ravnsborg is running against former two-term Governor Mike Rounds, who scoops up all the major Republican funding in the state and Washington, D.C. So Crow comes up with a strategy. He wants to sling enough mud at Rounds to force a runoff between the top two candidates.
We were going to run these TV ads for about a month, just swamp Fox News and the different news networks with them.
Crow says the ads will focus on several political scandals that popped up during Rounds' tenure as governor.
And in a runoff, heads up, I could have beaten Mike Rounds, and I knew it.
It's a long shot. To force a runoff, neither candidate can receive more than 35% of the vote.
That sort of defies political logic in South Dakota, at least from what I've seen, being around this stuff for 22 years.
That's Rob Schonsberg, Mike Rounds' campaign manager for the 2014 race.
A lot of these people get into these races that nobody knows, and they have a theory just like that, where you may, you know, you have name ID of 2.7%, and you think you're going to come out and you're going to start slamming a guy who's at 98% name ID. The problem with that theory is that in South Dakota, if people don't know you, it's really hard for them to support you when you're attacking someone else.
Rounds is the odds-on favorite, and Jason Ravnsborg, for all intents and purposes, is a political nobody. In 2014, SDPB reporter Charles Michael Ray asked Ravnsborg about his strategy to win the U.S. Senate Republican primary.
Mike Rounds is seen by many pundits as the front-runner in this race. He has the most money and is doing the most fundraising. What does it take to beat a candidate like this? Do you really think you have a chance against him?
Well, I do believe I have a chance against him. Yes, he has a lot of money, but how do you make up that difference? You get out there and you work. I think it is very sad that I am the fifth person to join this race, and I am the first person in so many towns that you would be astonished that I was the first person to go talk there.
And that is Jason Ravnsborg's blueprint for political success, to meet every local party official he can. Corey Heidelberger runs a liberal political blog focused on South Dakota politics. He suspects Ravnsborg enters that primary race with one thing in mind, to build a brand.
Didn't matter if he was going to win or lose. It was a chance in 2014 for Jason Ravnsborg to go to every rubber chicken Lincoln Day dinner around the state with all the Republicans and shake hands and say, "Hi, I'm Jason Ravnsborg. I'm running for Senate." And people say, "Oh, well, nice to meet you. We never heard of you." And he's like, "No, you haven't, but now you have." Ah.
But Ravnsborg's Senate campaign hits a snag during a Lincoln Day dinner in Lawrence County in the northern Black Hills. Campaign manager Crow says the cream of the crop of South Dakota's Republican Party is in attendance, including the governor at the time, Dennis Dugard.
And I'm standing in the corner drinking a Coke, and Governor Dugard walks up to me and says, "Ken, what are you doing here?" And I said, "Well, I'm here with my candidate." He goes, "You realize he doesn't want to win this." And I said, "Yeah, he does." "No, he doesn't." "Really? Why not?" He goes, "He's not supposed to win."
The way Crow remembers it, Dugard says Ravnsborg was supposed to split the hyper-conservative vote to clear a path for Rounds to clinch the nomination. In other words, Jason Ravnsborg would take one for the team.
And then next round, we make him attorney general. And then he serves two terms there, then he gets to run for governor.
That statement shocks Ken Crow. For what it's worth, Governor Dugard does not recall the conversation that Crow says took place, nor is Dugard known as this kind of political operative. Mike Rounds' campaign manager, Schonsberg, agrees.
The messenger with that plan was not Dennis Dugard. I would bet you a cheeseburger that didn't happen. The dude was in the margin of error, right? I mean, he was barely on the radar. And so he didn't split anything.
After the event is over, Crow says he spends the drive back to their hotel grilling Ravnsborg about his intentions in the Senate race. He wants to know if the effort to get people to sign his petitions, volunteer in his campaign, and donate money are all for nothing.
And we finally got out of the truck at the hotel. I looked him in the eye and I said, "Tell me you want to win this."
Crow says he doesn't get a straight answer.
And that's when I said, "Jason, I can't be a part of it." And I said, "I'm going home in the morning." And I did.
When primary election night results start pouring in, it doesn't look good for the Ravnsborg campaign. In fact, it looks really bad. Ravnsborg points to low voter turnout.
With as much interest as there's been in this race with five different candidates, I thought there'd be more people turning out to vote.
Of the nearly 75,000 votes cast, Ravnsborg gets 2,000, barely 3%. He places fifth out of five candidates, and it's not even close. Former Governor Mike Rounds mops up, getting over 55% of the vote, and in a few months, he'll head to Capitol Hill. The next statewide election Ravnsborg can run in is 4 years away. As he regroups, Ravnsborg shifts his focus from the general voting population to a smaller, more influential group. After a break, we'll follow that move as the story continues.
Short Walk is made possible with your Friends of SDPB membership and by the support of Explore South Dakota Fund. Corporate support for Short Walk comes from Turback Law Office in Watertown, attorneys handling insurance and personal injury claims. More at turbacklaw.com. For regular updates on all the news around the state, subscribe to The Morning Report, delivered twice a week to your inbox. We also produce a daily news podcast. You can find out more information about both at sdpb.org/news.
I'm Lee Strubinger, and this is SDPB's Short Walk, the story of a political career, a fatal crash, and the consequences. After his defeat in 2014, Jason Ravnsborg pivots his focus from the general voting population to the party influencers, each county's party delegates.
From there, Jason became a constant presence at almost any Republican event in the state. If there was a Republican event, no matter how small, Jason was there.
That's Pat Powers. He runs a conservative political blog called Dakota War College. It's a go-to information source for the South Dakota Republican Party.
Whether it was explaining ballot issues or just being there, and, you know, he was among the last to depart those events and helping to pack up tables and you know, that he literally ingratiated himself and got to know the people who vote in the delegate race in that manner.
Part of Ravnsborg's strategy for getting in front of county party Republicans is to offer a face-to-face presentation on a topic making plenty of news at the time. Liberal blogger Corey Heidelberger attended one of Ravnsborg's presentations.
In 2015, he went all around the state doing a roadshow on the history of Islam. And you'll remember, people were scared of ISIS at that point, you know, terrorism and the stuff going on in the Middle East. He was capitalizing on that Islamophobia that was going around and that people like Trump then stocked to kind of push their own political fortunes. He was going around South Dakota.
Heidelberger says Ravnsborg's presentation had a right-wing slant that is easily debunked with extra research. But Heidelberger says accuracy might not have been Ravnsborg's aim.
He was reaching, you know, older rural Republicans who were hearing on Fox News that Sharia law is evil and the Muslims were coming to kill us all. And now they had this, you know, reasonable young man in a suit, earnest, speaking, and he's been in the army, and he's just coming all this way from Yankton to talk to us about Islam and ISIS. Boy, how nice of him to do that. Boy, he's saying a lot of really intelligent things. Boy, they fit with everything I've heard too, so he must know what he's talking about.
Ravnsborg's work does not stop there. South Dakota is one of a few states that allow for ballot questions initiated by the public. they can offer a public policy workaround to the Republican-controlled state legislature. And in 2016, there were several. Ravnsborg hit the county circuit yet again to define what he called layman's terms for the many ballot questions voters would face. Again, Pat Powers.
No one at the time would say that Jason was lazy. No one would say anything except he was one of the hardest working men in state politics. I mean, he would get out there and press the flesh.
Powers says Ravnsborg was tireless in his efforts to reach county Republican officials. That's because they, in turn, would help him get the Republican nomination for attorney general.
Because remember, if you're looking ahead at running for attorney general in this state, you don't run in a primary. You run at convention.
The 2018 race for the Republican nomination for attorney general is tight. Marty Jackley, who's held the position for a decade, is term limited, and there are three candidates who want the job. Two West River lawyers and a little-known attorney from East River named Jason Ravnsborg. To an outsider, it's hard to explain, but the two sides, east and west of the Missouri River, present some very real social and economic distinctions. As for the two West River candidates, political blogger Pat Power says they face a serious logistical disadvantage.
You know, literally, they were trying to run statewide from far corners of the state, whereas Jason, located in Yankton, he could be up and down the I-29 corridor where most of the population is in a moment's notice.
The West River candidates would have to plan lengthy tours of the state, then return home to their law practice to make a living. Former Republican Representative Tim Goodwin is district mates with Lance Russell, one of the West River candidates running for attorney general. Lawrence County State's attorney John Fitzgerald is the other West River candidate. Goodwin says their opposing campaigns present a problem.
If we got to look at the lay of the land here, 75% of the population is East River, 25 here, and you're going to split the vote here, and he's going to, even if he doesn't do much, Jason Ravnsborg, you know, the cards aren't right to win this election. And so I was trying to get one of them to drop out. They both were great candidates, I thought.
But neither West River candidate wants to drop out. Then comes the convention. It starts on a Thursday and runs into Saturday morning for the big vote. For 3 days, the candidates shore up delegates to try to clinch the nomination. Political blogger Pat Power says Ravnsborg knows he has a comfortable lead.
Jason came in with a big head of steam, and the other two candidates just couldn't seem to get beyond their 20%. And that was at that point they decided to team up and started to get a little more negative against Jason in the convention race.
But going negative backfires. Jason Ravnsborg wins the second ballot with 63% of the vote. Moments after being nominated, as organizers disassemble the stage behind him, Ravnsborg tells the press he's on top of the world.
I've been to every county in our state at least twice. And I didn't just drive by a corner and count it as a county. I stopped and talked to people.
South Dakota is a deep red state, and most Republican candidates who earn the party's nomination are shoo-ins to win any statewide race. But Ravnsborg faces a solid Democratic opponent in the general election, former U.S. Attorney Randy Seiler. Ravnsborg says the campaign requires a shift in focus.
One of the advantages of going through this very heated process is that you have to test your organizational skills, which I think will also be a benefit to the fall campaign, because you're going to go out there and you're going to talk and organize and work in these individual counties now to turn out citizens, not just party delegates.
But some convention goers had serious questions about Ravnsborg's record as an attorney. In the heat of the nomination for attorney general, some wondered whether he had enough experience for the job. There's talk among attendees and delegates about whether Ravnsborg had ever even tried a jury trial. At the 2018 Republican convention, I asked him about that.
Have tried a jury trial, and I didn't know if you could clarify that for us.
Sure. I have tried jury trials, both criminal and civil. That there was a number of misconceptions or things in that tends to happen in any campaign, but I guess we're looking to move forward. I just look for the best result for my client, no matter if it is a jury trial, a court trial, or hopefully just a simple hearing. But the end result is the main thing, and helping victims and helping the people of our state. And that also includes not just in criminal, but also in consumer protection matters, and some of the things that are not as sexy or get as much attention as we talked about on the floor today, a little bit about the tax case that went to the United States Supreme Court.
Was that in Union County?
The tax case that I'm referring to is the United States Supreme Court case that Marty Jackley just argued, and they had the decision come down this week.
No, I meant the jury trial. Sorry.
Oh, yes. Most of my trials have been in other counties.
But the question of experience continues, and Ravnsborg's Democratic opponent has plenty of it. Randy Seiler has 22 years in the U.S. Attorney's Office, 14 years as a violent crimes prosecutor, 5 years as chief deputy to the U.S. attorney, and 3 as the U.S. attorney in South Dakota. Seiler has served under 9 U.S. attorneys and 4 presidents. He was the Hughes County State's attorney. He was the lead counsel in over 600 cases, including 75 jury trials. He also worked with the Lower Brule and Crow Creek Sioux tribes to provide advice and prosecutorial services. During a candidate debate on SDPB's South Dakota Focus, Seiler leans into his experience.
The Attorney General's office is the largest law firm in South Dakota. You have to have executive management experience. I've had that in state government. I've had it with the U.S. Attorney's office.
But that experience is not enough to launch Randy Seiler into office. Jason Ravnsborg is endorsed by a majority of sheriffs in the state, as well as state's attorneys in 30 different counties. That proves decisive on election day when Ravnsborg gets 55% of the vote. 2 months later, he's sworn into office, January 5th, 2019.
And the laws of the state of South Dakota, and that I will faithfully perform the duties of Attorney General of the state of South Dakota. So help me God.
Congratulations, Mr. Attorney General.
South Dakota has a long history of electing Republican attorneys general. Only 4 Democrats have held the position. The job can be used as a stepping stone to the governor's office, including most recently by former governors Frank Farrar and Bill Janklow. The trajectory for Jason Ravnsborg is all but set, but then comes the dark night when he hits something in the road.
Mash my windshield.
Oh no, okay, do you think it was a deer or something?
Did he vomit?
I have no idea.
Okay.
Yeah, it could be. I mean, it's... It was right in the roadway.
That's next time on Short Walk. I'm Lee Strubinger. I wrote, reported, and produced this episode. Kate Smith edited the script. Josh Chilson is our news director. Kara Hetland, our director of journalism. Twyla Olson is our director of content. SDPB's executive director is Julie Overgaard. Thanks to Matt Lachois and Flower Room Records, who created the show's music. Special thanks to the South Dakota Press Corps, representing various organizations who provided dedicated coverage of this story along the way, including Stephen Groves, Christopher Vondrachik, Joe Sneeby, Austin Goss, Ariel Zients, Patrick Callahan, Abby Wargo, Joshua Heyer, Jonathan Ellis, Jackie Hendry, Seth Tupper, and Bob Mercer. Be sure to check out more at sdpb.org/shortwalk. Please rate and review the show on Apple Podcasts or wherever you get your podcasts. Join me for the next episode of Short Walk.